Good morning.
Now, Commissioner, the significance of this amendment, we note that the old Public Service Act has been decades there. So how will this change in terms of investments in the Philippines?
Well, like for example, the telecommunication. If before Elon Musk, the Starlink, has to talk to somebody so that he can come in here, so he has to joint venture with a Filipino company. Now he doesn't have to do that. No? He can do it on his own. Because the PSA now basically amended the provision that allows a foreigner, a company that's 100% foreign owned, to do this activity. So in that sense, you have more competition. You have more, let's say, if you have more choice. So if you want to connect to your phone, you can now choose another company aside from the three existing companies, and you can choose another technology other than the three existing companies.
And this will hopefully spur the introduction of new technology in the country as well, Commissioner Inares, would it not? That new developments in terms of innovation in how we, for example, transact could be introduced in the Philippines.
Yeah, but you have to remember, the investor experience is not only the loan, it's their actual experience on the ground. So this is only one hurdle that has been, one obstacle that has been removed, but there's going to be a lot of other obstacles, like basically ease of doing business. Okay, you're allowing them to do business here. They still have to deal with what the domestic corporation have to deal with, which is their complaint. It is hard to register a business. Yearly, they're being assessed. They're being audited. And they have to deal with the local government and all those things. But of course, like I said, the technology that's virtual, you might no longer have to deal with several LGUs because you just have to deal with the LGU where you will have your principal office. So you won't be putting up any physical facilities anyway. That's for the telecommunication. But let's say for the others, for the railway and all the same, these are hard infrastructure. Their problem will be the same, right away. Then after they built the railway, getting fare increases, being assessed real property tax by local government where the rail passes. So there still are a lot of problems. It's not a magic bullet. It just solved one aspect.
And of course, Commissioner Inares, not included in the liberalization is the ownership of mass media. Mass media is still 100% fully, or must be still be 100% Filipino owned. But how do we reconcile the logic behind this? The fact that we don't want foreigners to control mass media, and yet we allow foreigners to control telecommunications, which is also a means of spreading information. So if the concern is that we don't want foreigners to have control over mass media, they could easily do that through telecommunications. So how do we reconcile that?
Well, I guess the mass media, you want to have control over content. Telecommunication is just the transmission, but it's useless if you don't have content, right? So I think that's the reconciliation. We want to have control over content of what is being put out in public. Because remember, culture is very localized. It's where it you cannot find it anywhere. It's in the Philippines, right? Values are different. What we think are good values might not be what other people think it should be. They have different set of values, so depending on what country you're talking about. And I guess the government wants to have a overall supervision. And, you know, if you're a Filipino, because you're in the Philippines, it's easy to impose laws and to enforce them. But when you start dealing with foreigners, of course, they're complaining to their government, and the embassy will start talking to the national government here. So I think that's where the difference lies.
Mm-hmm. All right, let me shift gears now, Commissioner Inaras, to the burning issue of the day, and which is really the 203 billion peso unpaid estate tax of the Marcoses. And just to be clear, this is not alleged, this is not in Tagalog umano, this is a fact and not fake news, Commissioner Inaras.
Yeah, there's a Supreme Court decision. Everyone can go to the database of the Supreme Court, and basically the Supreme Court decision said that the estate of Ferdinand Marcos Sr. is liable for estate tax, and the basic estate tax liability is around 23.3 billion. Mm-hmm. If I understand it correctly, and this was due within 1 year. In the old law, it said it's due within 9 months, or you can extend it to 1 year. And if you don't pay it within that period, a surcharge will be imposed and interest will be imposed. And during those times, the interest rate is 20% per annum.
So that's how it amounted to 203 billion pesos. And that's the computation, Commissioner Inaras, from 23 billion to 203 billion pesos as of now.
Yeah, I take the 203 billion as, I don't know whether that's exactly the amount or not, but because along the way, the BIR has attached 11 set of property. Mm-hmm. But I don't, the only time that the tax will be lowered because of those 11 properties when the BIR is able to sell those properties, so that whatever amount it is sold for, that's going to be applied to the tax liability. So, of course, there's going to be every year, it's a moving amount, mm-hmm. because it's an interest that kicks in every year. So that 203 billion might not anymore be 203 billion, it might be more.
Mm-hmm. And the fact that the BIR has already wrote a letter to the Marcoses last December about this amount. So for now, that's the amount that we're talking about. And there could be a different computation in the next few years if it's still unpaid. The question here, Commissioner Inaras, how did this happen that you have an uncollected 23 billion peso estate tax from one of the more well-known families in the Philippines, and yet the BIR was unable to collect it for how many years? Decades even.
Yeah, but you know, when the BIR give an assessment and you don't collect, the first default of BIR when it becomes final and executory is to go look for assets, mm-hmm. of the taxpayer, then attach it, levy on it, and auction it off, and then the amount that's applied to the tax liability for the Marcos estate. There's a lot of difficulty because, one, a lot of their properties were sequestered. Mm-hmm. So because it's sequestered, it's already now owned by government, BIR cannot go and levy on this property. And that was not included in the estate tax return. Second, a lot of their property are abroad. Mm-hmm. So now in the BIR, cannot go abroad and attach those property because we don't have any jurisdiction. That's why during my term as commissioner, we recommended that the Philippines sign the Multilateral Assistance Convention that OECD has basically, OECD country and other countries basically agreed upon. Under this convention, a country can seek assistance from another country to help it collect taxes that has been final from it, if there's any asset of the taxpayer in that country. As of now, we don't have that tool so that we can go and collect. There is such a provision for, there are countries that have provision that will help another country to seize illegally obtained wealth, but not mm-hmm. something about helping other country on their own, on the law of their own country, helping other countries to collect or seize asset as payment of tax liability. That's why there's a move among all the countries to have this multilateral assistance convention.
Commissioner Inares, there's been a comment online by one of the analysts in support of Bongbong Marcos saying that if you have this obligation to pay 203 billion pesos of estate tax, then that means there's no ill-gotten wealth because supposedly estate tax attaches only to legally acquired properties. Is that a sound argument in support of the Marcoses?
First, for taxation, it's agnostic. We don't really care. Like I already said when I was commissioner, all income is taxable, no matter how you got it. In estate tax, all as long as it's in your name when you die and you own it, it is taxable. We don't really ask how you got it or whether all those things. As long as it's in your name at the time of your death, or you say that it's in your possession, if it's personal property, and you claim that it is yours. For excise tax, it's the same thing. Whoever possess the thing that is excisable and cannot show that excise tax has been paid, the law can confiscate that thing, even if it is not held by, let's say, you have in possession with you Johnny Walker Blue, and then there's no proof that there's an excise tax payment. Even if you say you just bought it in a store, we can put the law says that thing can be confiscated. So as far as taxation is concerned, it does not matter. Secondly, the estate tax does not include sequestered property. Because first, sequestered property is no longer owned by the, when it was sequestered, Marcos Sr. was still alive, right? So the ownership of those sequestered property moved to the government of the Philippines. Therefore, it is no longer owned at the time of death of Marcos, and therefore not included in the estate tax. Now there's an argument that this commentator said that Sandigan Bayan said there are lists of ill-gotten wealth that must be returned to the Marcoses. Now, if it is returned and that decision is final and executory, then there should be an amendatory, then they should again supplement the estate tax return that was filed and pay estate tax on those additional thing or asset. And at the same time, before it is returned to the Marcoses, the government can now attach those property to satisfy the liability of 203 billion pesos.
And Commissioner Inares, there was also an argument here coming from the Marcos camp. They're saying that the reason why they're not paying yet is that some of these properties are still under litigation. And so therefore it's not clear yet, supposedly which amount needs to be paid. And there is supposedly an agreement between the PCGG and the BIR not to collect assets that are still under litigation. What do you make of it? Is that an excuse not to pay up?
First, like I said, the estate tax return does not include sequestered assets. I presume if they are under litigation, first, they are already in the name of the government of the Philippines. So first, it's not included in the estate tax because when Marcos Sr. died, it was already in the name of the Republic of the Philippines. Now, I would believe that they are questioning the sequestration. So I would believe the decision of the court will be to say, like what this commentator alleged, that the Sandigan Bayan's decision is to return those assets to the Marcoses. Now, that's a separate issue. When you return it, then you add it to the estate. Secondly, if there is such agreement, it has been overturned already by events, no? Because if there is such an agreement, the BIR would not have had filed an estate tax return for the Marcoses. The mere fact that it was filed and that BIR is demanding for payment basically said there's no agreement, or if there's an agreement, it has nothing to do with assets that are not sequestered.
And the significance, Commissioner Inara, is that the fact that the Supreme Court ruling in 1997 has long become final and executory, can at this point the Marcoses still contest the amount?
No, they should have contested. They should have appealed the decision when the Supreme Court came up with that decision. And they have 30 days, I believe, to have appealed it. Now, if they did not, so it's now final and executory and it's no longer appealable. So it's now actually part of the jurisprudence, right?
In that decision, Commissioner, in the narration of facts in that decision, it said that there was no notice of death, there was no estate tax return filed, so it was the Commissioner of Internal Revenue who caused the filing of the tax return. There was a deficiency estate tax assessment, and copies were served, and these were not contested or protested administratively within a certain given period. So the whole process, can the Marcoses now say, we were not given due process as they argued before the Supreme Court in terms of the assessment? Because when you look at the other case against Bongbong Marcos, the Court of Appeals in removing the jail term against him and acquitting him of tax evasion actually used that argument that it was not Bongbong Marcos who filed the income tax return and that he could not have known about the deficiency because he was paying income tax return. So the question here is, can that same argument be raised with respect to the estate tax?
First, if there was no due process, it was remedied when he filed his appeal in the Supreme Court. Right? So all his argument as to why the assessment is not valid had already been litigated in the Supreme Court, right? So I would not say that he was already given the opportunity to question all of this, and the decision said they are liable, right? So, you can no longer talk about not being given the opportunity because you filed the appeal in the Supreme Court. So that is the opportunity. And second, it's already, if there was a tax amnesty law that was passed, or wherein you can pay 50% of basic to settle your liability, because these are final and executory decisions. So this is not covered by the estate tax amnesty law, which was extended to June 14, 2023. This is covered by the first tax amnesty law, and the deadline was June 14, 2021. Under that first tax amnesty law, if you have a final and executory deficiency assessment, you can actually avail of the amnesty by paying 50% of the basic charges.
So they could have paid at least half of that, and this would have gone away.
Yes. But unfortunately, that opportunity has passed.
And Commissioner Inares, the common argument that pro-Marcos supporters are saying in favor of Bongbong Marcos is that the sins of the father could not be attributed to the son. In this case, the non-payment of estate tax, can they actually make the same argument?
Okay. The estate tax by its nature, the person whose estate is being taxed cannot file or pay because he's dead. So under the tax code, it said that the one who has a liability, who has an obligation to file the return first, has the obligation to file the notice of death, has an obligation to file the estate tax return, and an obligation to pay the taxes are the executor or administrator or the legal heirs. So it's very clear those are the people who will be, who are responsible and obligated to do this thing. And there's also a provision there that the executor, administrator, and legal heirs cannot, or the executor, administrator cannot distribute the asset from the estate to anyone unless estate tax is paid. Mm-hmm. And if you do that, there are criminal liabilities for that.
Mm-hmm. All right. So thank you so much for clarifying certain issues, certain tax issues amid the confusion on social media. Former BIR Commissioner Kim Inaris.
Thank you.